white body, I quote, "We whose shame, humiliation, and deep insult his aggrandizement so often involved were never deceived. We looked at him clearly with world-old eyes and saw simply a human thing, weak and pitiable and cruel, even as we are and were." If the message of the gospel is that humans are simply creatures awaiting the justification and judgment of God, then the universalizing tendencies of white folks' often optimistic theological anthropologies must be chastened, which is a claim I will develop in the next section. When we as white folks think that Western civilization is the apex of what it means to be human, we necessarily engage others from a self-imposed position of condescension, no matter how much we talk about inclusion and diversity. This indicates that we believe our theologies, our preaching, our art forms, and our worship practices are the standard, while the practices of people of color are specialist interests, right, ethnic experiences, or expressions of diversity. Yeah. Now, many know that I'm implicitly drawing on James' contention that the theological deformity of supersessionism is constitutive of racialized imagination, but it's not my goal to reconstruct that genealogy in detail, but rather, my contention is that the tradition or traditions of Western Christian orthodoxy, follow me here, while not monolithic in a reductionist sense, are nonetheless best understood as one particular inculturation or cluster of Hellenized appropriations of faith in the Jewish Messiah and should not be read uncritically in a universalized fashion. Now, I find compelling Russell Gonzalez's claim that the 19th Christian tradition more sufficiently reflected on the doctrinal implications of the claim that the Jewish Jesus of Nazareth is the Savior of the world than the comparatively over-systematized heresies of the first few centuries of Gentile Christian faith. At the same time, Gonzalez notes the psychological, sociological, and racial implications of the 19th tradition's use of language and formulation foreign to the biblical witness. Similarly, Kinzer compellingly demonstrates that both the patristic luminaries and the conciliar formulations went to great lengths to define Christianity as a religious system distinct from and even opposed to Judaism and continued Jewish adherence to Torah. In other words, from the Jerusalem Council in Acts 15, the burden of proof in patristic literature switched from the burden of proof being on Gentiles and dealing with the Jewish people to the burden of proof switching to Jews to see if they could worship their own Messiah as Gentiles. And this was the work of, by and large, the Western tradition. And if we read the Christian tradition, then in particular in cultural region of faith in the Jewish Messiah, we can read this book helpful and problematic. That's why we're free to read with the communion of saints in both generous and critical ways. Theological projects that derive their energy primarily from reclamations of the tradition often underestimate the extent to which their doctrinal systems and ecclesial practices reenact the memory of white pagan gods of race and religion. This theological hubris has far-reaching implications for how we think about mission, race, wealth, and criminality, and is the core of the systemic sin of which white Christians must repent. This means that common Western missiological questions related to protecting against syncretism and the proclamation of the gospel are usually fundamentally flawed because they tend to position Western Gentile Christians as capable of judging the relative cultural merits of others while forgetting our own cultural situatedness. Number two, white Christians must learn from theological and cultural resources not our own. The centering of whiteness is concomitant with situating the white male heterosexual able body as constitutive of the Christian body, both individual bodies and the body politic. By making this claim, I'm not suggesting that race, gender, and disability are interchangeable sites of identity, even less that they should be reified, but rather that whiteness seems to orbit around maleness and ableism as all as an ideal form of the human. Therefore, my claim that whiteness is idolatry is not a suggestion that all white folks experience white privilege in the same manner. And this is important to recognize, especially as we think about, and I'm not justifying their racism, but marginalized, impoverished, rural white folks who have been taught to think they are better than somebody else just because of race. So we need to carefully distinguish this matter. So it's not that white privilege is born in the same manner by all people, but rather that the benefits and burdens of whiteness are leveraged and borne by many different groups of people in various ways and for various projects, an insight that is pursued in recent scholarship related to intersectionality. It is through learning from from theological and cultural traditions that are not white, read that are not, quote, traditioned accounts by only white males, that white folks can begin a process of decentering our own theological and philosophical presuppositions as universally normative, while seeing whiteness for what it is, a weak and pitiable longing to be divine. Now, I'm not going to read this section in detail because I want to respect the time. In this section, I just deal briefly with Latin American liberation theology, several African American church traditions, feminist and womanist thought. There are plenty of great resources out there to different schools of thought. I'm going to demonstrate right now how I juxtapose personal examples with the conceptual apparatus that I'm building. If you want to know more about some of the apparatus that I'm building, you can also get my books.